Good morning to everyone present here, first of all. So I thank my head of the department, principal and the management of PSG College of Technology. Because of them, I think I am being here. So I am from PSG College of Technology, Dominic Savio, senior lecturer working as in Department of Information Technology. So computer programming syllabus, even though it's common in all branches, still some mild variations may be there, like for IT and CSE and for other branches. So here we can see the syllabus for IT department. So the code 08, it is normal and as usual, like programming languages, C, control statements, functions, arrays, pointers, structures, unions, files, pre-process, and these are the textbooks as usual, I think. This is normal, which is followed in most of the universities and colleges, I think.
What are the numbers in the bracket?
I think this stands for the number of hours allotted for that. That is totally 42 hours. So this is the evaluation pattern we follow, I think, since it is an autonomous institution. For all UG courses, we have this type of pattern, 50-50. And out of this 50-50, this theory test, that what we called as a, it will be taking average of best of 2 out of 3, best 2 out of 3, and that the average will be taken, that 30 marks, theory test. And remaining 20 marks, it's left to the staff member who is handling the paper. Because of this particular paper, C programming for laboratory 10 marks, quiz 5 marks, assignment 5 marks has been assigned, and still it may vary from teacher to teacher. It's not compulsory. A teacher can follow anything else as she wishes, like they can, sometimes they may give a package development in C and so on, or some video games, and it depends upon the department, it depends upon the staff member who is handling. With respect to them, it will vary. That is 20 marks. And the end semester assessment, that is 50 marks. And these are some lab sample lab experiments. And normally what happens is, like, we have totally 3 hours theory session, 2 hours lab every week, and each week some problem sheet will be given, which may range from 5 to 10 problems. Like, these are some sample problems. Again, this may also vary from teacher to teacher. It is not necessary or compulsory that it should be, it is common. And some of the, in particular, like other branches like mechanical, triple EEC, IC, and so many other departments are there, except CSE and IT. Those departments, I think it is handled by Maths and Computer Applications Department, C language. So they may be having some common problem sheets, which they may give in advance as a Xerox material, or else they may put in intranet. I don't think they are putting in net.
This is not a common course. It is a common course.
Still, as I told, for IT and CSE, some mild variations may be there in syllabus.
The syllabus is different for
Some mild variations may be there. Because what happens is that other students, that is other department students, they have a feel that why we have to put more pressure, like IT and CSE students, to learn this type of C programming. That type of feeling they also have. So as a result, I think management has decided, okay, we'll have a separate syllabus for IT, CSE, and other engineering branches. This is one more sample. So it varies from teacher to teacher. And as I told earlier, model question paper, I think this is the continuous assessment which I was talking about, 30 marks. This earlier the system was different, and now they have changed. Earlier it was for 30 marks itself. The test will be for 1.5 hours. I think now they have squeezed the time to 1 hour 10 minutes, and the test will be conducted only for 20 marks. And this 20 will be converted into 30, for the sake of for that 30. That is this.
Convert larger marks into smaller marks.
This is what happens currently. They want to actually planning for some change, still in discussion, because this is common for all UG courses. And this internal question paper again, and the teacher is going to set, who is handling the paper. And this is four, it's compulsory. And this we give 2 into 6, 2 questions, it's compulsory, they have to answer, only one choice. So this is a sample BTEC question paper. I think we have courses like even BSc also in our college, MSc, MCA and so on. That is UG courses, we have some common pattern. The PG, I think, I don't remember the pattern. I think it's flexible enough, in the sense the teacher can set his own standard and so on. And this is a pattern that is 10 into 2, 20 marks and so on. Two mark question will be having. And then this is 5 into 6, 30 marks. This 30 marks, it depends upon the staff members who is handling the paper. 30 marks is allotted. You can go for 4 into 7.5, or whatever else he likes, he can go. And you can include A or B or subsections. Again, it's left to the teacher. This is a sample question. And we have objective. That is one mark question. And this one mark question, what is the beauty is, we give this question paper that is in particular one mark only after 2.5 hours in the end semester exam. So first 2.5 hours, they will be writing only group 2 and group 3. That is this, that one mark question they will be answering only at the end of, that is last half an hour. Totally exam, I think it's for 3 hours. And normally I think we have a practice before, after taking the question paper, some committee has been formed, they scrutinize the question paper and so on. And our lab IT department, we have 144 notes. I think normally in our lab we are not, so many students are not using Linux. They use only Windows. And we have a new network lab which has 16 nodes. That is the lab facility we have. And thank you. Any questions?
You do not keep the material on internet, you keep it only on intranet, most of it. Would the old question papers be available as soft copies in the department?
Actually, what is happening is there is a in intranet itself, they have a digital library something. Digital library, these old question papers, they are making it available.
Old style, question paper.
Old question papers.
This I would like to request everybody, if your college or university has a mechanism of having old question papers, Because old question papers are out of copyright. They are public information. And it might be useful for us to start with a complete set of all those problems. It's like what students may call guidebooks. But essentially, developing an answer, giving reasoning, much more than the guidebook, giving multiple ways of answering the same question. Or even for objective type questions, not just pointing out the correct answer, but giving a reason why that is correct answer. You agree that it would be useful? So I'll request all of you that wherever you can get soft copies, please mail them to Kalpana. Wherever, or old copies or whatever. And if any permission or anything is required, I'll be glad to write to the authorities, but I don't think that should be a problem for old papers. Even if you cannot locate old papers, but you lay your hands on books which are published by outsiders, which actually contain question papers, hard copies. Yes. I could get them entered here, you know. It's not a problem. But I think I am planning with something like 5,000 to 6,000 questions, not just objective but detailed questions and their answers, to come out of this collaborative effort. Now for that, I should have a ready-made set of problems stated at least.
And question papers came from 2005.
Very good. So I'll request all of you, this is an action item, we'll note later that we'll mail these things. The second point I made, this is a pedagogical issue. You mentioned that the other students feel why they should do so much of programming, because programming is perceived to be for computer science or IT people. In exactly the same way, the computer science students feel, why should they know more about thermodynamics? Because that is part of mechanical engineering. But at least the engineering and science education at the entry level works or designed on the premise that every scientist or engineer must know a few basic things about all topics. In fact, earlier at my time when the engineering course used to be 5 years duration, we used to have 2 years of common courses. It doesn't matter whether you were to become an electrical engineer, mechanical engineer, civil engineer, you had to know something about all engineering necessarily. The second point is, some students are permitted to change their branch after first year.
I think in our college it is.
They are not permitted, straight jacketed. Once you are branded civil engineer, you have to be a civil engineer.
Yes.
And therefore, you must not know anything about computer programming.
Yes.
The topmost civil engineers, particularly in the structural design business, are far better software engineers than many computer scientists I have seen. They are required to be so. Their problems today cannot be solved. So I would like to request you to go back.
Even I think my head of the department is mechanical engineer.
Yes.
And then he did his MS in computer science in US and completed his PhD.
The point I am trying to make is you must impress upon all students and the teachers that they must not dilute the programming knowledge given at the entry level to any student. The dilution may happen at the BSc first year because the maturity is less. But at MSc first year or BE first year, I think they should be expected to do that. Personally, I don't see any reason why BSc first year should be any less, because whatever you have described. Sorry for this digression, but is this not the philosophy everywhere that a computer programming common course is common for all students, right? Right. That's right. That's right. But for our purposes, a syllabi such as this could be very easily a guiding factor, because I am seeing again and again and again that the first course syllabus is almost identical in most places. So as we discussed yesterday, day for yesterday, we will concentrate on that as the syllabus. Now what I saw is distinction between the number of hours that are allocated to different topics. At different places there is slight variation. And if possible, if you could just concentrate on this aspect, that is, or maybe we'll do it in my session, that we'll just go step by step and everybody will ask how many hours at your place, how many hours at your place. We'll write down each and then we'll try to decide what should be our approach. I think that would be best. Okay, thank you, Dominic.
Sometimes, no, we have been seeing most of the time the other branch students also will be appearing for the placements in software firms, and it will be very difficult if they don't have a good background in computer programming and basic concepts. So initially itself we'll make them understand that it's very, very important for them in case if they would prefer to attend some placement interviews in software firms. So
I'll tell you, in IIT, for example, the placement situation. Last year was bad universally, but it was not uncommon to see Infosys hiring 120 people, TCS hiring 200 people, not a single computer science person. Because computer science students don't want to join TCS and Infosys. They want to write compilers.
But when they come for the first year, no, they always target to their core companies yeah, and all. Yeah. Then later on, they understand that it's quite difficult and they switch to the software
anyway,
first.
But I think the point is made. He also said that he did not approve of this position, but he was just stating the realistic life as it obtains there. Because non-CS students, the problem is with the student's mindset. Just like, I will tell you, this is just reverse the situation. Computer science students, do they take thermodynamics seriously? Do they take workshop seriously? I'll digress for 2 more minutes to tell you an incident which happened many, many years ago. You remember the computers used to be horizontal earlier. They became vertical at some point in time. The first such vertical model was brought to my lab and my students had opened it up. And all that fellow had done is, he had just put it ulta like this. The legs were fitted here. The power supply, which is the heaviest unit, was on the top. Now the cards, the electronic cards, which would be put, like today you got a single motherboard doing everything or single chip doing everything, those were not the days. So the cards which are like this, there's a fan behind and the fan is throwing air, the air circulation is good. Now when you invert it, the fan is at the bottom, and the airflow is blocked by the first card itself. There is not enough airflow above. When I saw that, instantly I realized this is nonsense. I asked my students, don't you see that something is wrong with this? They move around, they said, no sir, it has been working for the last 2 days. Now in an air-conditioned lab, any goddamn thing will work. So I asked them, what about the center of gravity? So one student asked me, sir, this is a computer, meaning computers are not supposed to have center of gravity. Then he realized, I said, where is the power supply? Then students are smart, they figured out, yes sir, it should be at the bottom, common sense at least. Then I said, what about the heat flow? And you know the remarkable answer I got, this B.Tech computer science student of IIT Bombay, toppers from JE all across the country, okay? Heat flow, sir, that is a mechanical engineering problem. I will have nothing to do it effectively. Now this is the mindset of the students, and I think as teachers, particularly as first year teachers, it is important for us to convey to all students that we teach that look, this bifurcation of silos has been made only to handle growing body of knowledge in respective fields. The real life problems never come with a stamp that I am a mechanical engineering problem, I am an electrical engineering problem, I am computer, I am a problem, solve it. And basically we are training people to be problem solvers. Now this emphasize is not written anywhere in the syllabus. There is no subject which emphasizes this part. So I think that has to be the responsibility of the teachers, particularly first year teachers. So my humble suggestion is that while we concentrate on computer programming at this course, but we should emphasize this part wherever discreetly, indirectly possible. And the subsequent courses, for example, thermodynamics is going to be covered by my colleague, Professor Uday Gayatonde, an national expert. So he also says the same thing, that many non-mechanical engineering people think thermodynamics is useless. Whereas according to him, that governs life. Actually, that is the peculiarity. Every teacher of any subject genuinely believes that that subject is most important in the world. All other things are secondary. And that only proves my point. That means all subjects are important. Anyway. So this is something that we would like to remember. And this is the reason why, if you recall what Professor Ranade said, he would not like to start a lecture saying we'll discuss arrays or we'll discuss pointers. Say we'll discuss a problem. And the opportunity that we have as computer science teachers is much more than anybody else. We can actually take problem from any field and use that problem to illustrate to students that look, problems from this domain, this domain, this domain can be solved using computer. Okay. Thank you, Dominic.
Thank you, sir.